Donna Stetzer. Hello, welcome to this edition of Global Reiki Webinars. It's June 7th, 2016, and we have a really exciting program for you today. Phyllis is going to be talking with us about the four aspects of a Reiki system and how that evolved over the history of Reiki practice. And oh my goodness, I'm looking at the chat where everyone is joining us from. We've got Hong Kong, Estonia, Vladivostok, Russia. Phyllis is actually in Moscow, Russia right now. We've got someone from Colombia, Oregon, Florida, a lot of people from the Pacific Northwest, Barcelona, a lot of people from Russia and a lot of people from Kazakhstan today. That's exciting. Israel, Norway, Georgia, Canada, Washington, England, Ukraine, Netherlands, Holland. This is truly a global community, and it exists because you're here, and it's really awesome. What Global Reiki Webinars is, if this is your first time joining us, is Phyllis Furumoto, who is the lineage bearer and grandmaster of Usui Shiki Ryoho, is doing these public broadcasts completely free for the global Reiki community every 4 to 6 weeks. We started about a year ago. And if you're interested in seeing past episodes, you can find them on YouTube if you just search Global Reiki Webinars, or you can join the discussion and join the ongoing community action on Facebook in our private forum, which is just called Global Reiki Webinars. So if you go and search Global Reiki Webinars on Facebook, someone who you are already friends with or myself will approve you to join the group, and you can come in and introduce yourself and say whatever really excited you about this intimate conversation with Phyllis Furumoto. So for those of you who are on live, you will receive a link tomorrow with a replay that includes all the chat, and you can absolutely share that with your friends. If you're interested in getting the controls, there is a YouTube logo down in the corner that you can click on, and that'll take you to watch the broadcast in YouTube, but you won't have all of the interaction of the chat. And that's the same in the replay. And if you found us on YouTube and you wanna know how you can get on live, go on over to that Facebook forum, Global Reiki Webinars, and that's where you will get all that information from here on out. So we've got Ballard from France, more people from different states in the US, really exciting. I'm going to close my screen now. Thank you and welcome everyone who's joining us. And here is Phyllis Furumoto.
Hello, everyone. Here we are together while I'm in Moscow. Last week, the weather here was like idyllic. It was so beautiful. And now it's beautiful spring weather, kind of chilly, rainy, with a little wind. So I'm glad I'm inside, cozy, and with you. I'd like for us to start today, as usual, by having everyone close their eyes and treat themselves with Reiki. And when you have your eyes closed, just imagine us all together in some very large room that spans the globe. Thank you. I just feel the connection with all of you, and it, with every webinar, I think it is growing stronger. I just think we're getting used to it. And it's a wonderful thing to just stretch our minds out and connect and know that we don't really need telephones to have conversations, as we know. But telephones are great, and webinars are one step better because you can see me, and we're really hoping that someday I'll be able to see you. That would be the next big step for me. Today, I'd like to talk about the four aspects of a Reiki practice. And one of the reasons why is because we've spoken about each of them in one of the other webinars individually. And it was important for me to not have them kind of float in space, but to be able to bring them together and to pass on my understanding of how they are inherent in a Reiki practice, even though they aren't articulated mostly, and sometimes they're not even conscious. So I'd like to give you a little history about how I got to the aspects, because I hope that it will assist you in following some of my references later on. In 1993, I began my engagement with a series of master intensives called Usui Shiki Ryoho Master Intensives 1, which ended up getting shortened to Usui 1 and Usui 2, which was a relief. And these master's intensives were for masters who wished to become acquainted with the principles and the practice of Usui Shiki Ryoho, or to deepen this practice that Hawaii Otakata passed down to us. We were asked to do this by members of the Reiki Alliance in 1992, and our first one was held in the winter of 1993 in January in Germany. After the second one, in May of that same year, I was needing to write an article for my own newsletter, and I was living in Santa Fe, New Mexico at the time. And all of a sudden, this writing came out, and I was writing about four aspects and nine elements. And I have to be really clear that this was not channeled in the sense of that it just sprang up from nothing. It was a accumulation of many, many conversations I had had with the Reiki Alliance masters, with other masters, with my own musings, and it just seemed to come together one day and flowed through my fingers into the keyboard of my fairly brand new computer at the time, and became an article. So that's when the four aspects emerged, and they were articulated a little different. Like, instead of healing practice, it was something like, well, now I don't even remember what it was, but it was a little different. So the four aspects, as they are now, are healing practice, personal development, spiritual discipline, and mystic order. Back to the intensives. Paul Mitchell, a master who was initiated by Hawaii Otakata shortly before her death, and also became a teaching partner of mine because of the intensives, began to do research with the members of the masters who were initiated by Hawaii Otakata. And we wanted to find out more about what they remembered as the form of practice from Hawaii Otakata. And we took all of this information and looked at those things that all of us did and created this kind of pattern that began to be the form of this practice. Because at this time, in the early 1990s, there were a lot of different forms of practice that were beginning to emerge. And it was important for us to understand where our identity began and where it ended. And so this was a part of our process. One of the things that was really interesting is that as we started to clarify what our practice was, both Paul and I discovered that, of course, we had added things individually to our practice, usually to make it clearer, or obviously because we were insecure about what we were offering. And 13 years after Hawaii Otakata's death, when we were discovering this, we realized that actually these kinds of little things that we added didn't make our practice more clear. It actually made it a little bit more confusing, and that we weren't insecure anymore. So we could drop these from our teaching. This particular process of finding out what the actual form of the practice was, and then dropping those practices that we added, and then also adding practices that we had dropped because we didn't think they were relevant or didn't know how to explain them, we added that back in. So this process was called coming into alignment. And that was a process that took some years. And now, I think for Paul and I, and also for the masters who have come through the program, these years have been really valuable in taking and allowing our form to become not dogma, but a living entity that has for us always new teachings, new insights, and new combinations of understanding. I just will talk about my own experience of these little practices so that you understand what I'm talking about. So for instance, during the 1980s, I became very enamored with something called the Game of Transformation. It's a box game that we use for personal development. And in this box game, there are angel cards. And a lot of you are familiar with these little cards that have a little photo picture of an angel and then a word like gratitude or healing or inspiration or appreciation and so on. And these cards were used very often in Reiki classes in the 1980s. We would have them in a basket, and as students would come in, people would draw an angel card, and they would have this angel for their class. And we all thought it was very supportive and so on. But I realized while we were clarifying that they were confusing, because what happened was they brought in the whole energetic of the Game of Transformation, which was compatible, of course, to the energy of Reiki. But in teaching a first degree class, it isn't really something that I wanted the class to remember was drawing angel cards. I wanted them to remember hand positions. So this was a very good realization. So these were very little things, but I just wanted you to know that this process also happened with me as well. So we're teaching the master intensives, and during the first years, we offered three Usui ones, and then we ended up very shortly realizing that we couldn't open the total practice to everybody within 3.5 days, which is the amount of time of the Usui one. So we added another one called Usui two, and that's 5 days, five full days, and it is sequential to Usui one, we recommend a year between the two. And in Usui 2, we go through the whole practice as a master. We talk about we talk and demonstrate the initiations. We go through the symbols and the nine elements, which form the basis of our practice. And what happens when we do this is that it's not about coming to a first degree class. It's much more than that. Each element has a background. It has the way that we hold the element, the way that we practice the element, and also how the element is connected to the other elements of the practice. So it takes a lot longer. And also in the Usui 2, we're pretty committed to answering every question that a master asks. So that's the difference between Usui 1 and Usui 2. And it's a program that people do come through sometimes. So last few years, Paul and I have not had such a high demand for the Usui 1 and Usui 2. In my estimation, it's because this information has spread out into the master community. And also, I feel that masters who practice other forms are becoming more comfortable with their form. They're not looking for the right answer so much, or they're beginning to see that their own form has its own integrity and its own its own substance. So that's really great for me. And we still offer these about once a year, and usually they're offered in the United States because we're trying to cut down on our traveling time as well. About a year ago, Paul and I decided that we were ready to offer an Usui 3, which was held in Moscow last week. And Paul and I prepared for this for about a year, actually, and very dedicatedly for the last 6 months, because we wanted to take a next step deeper into the four aspects. And this process became so profound for myself and for the people who are the masters who attended this intensive. We really went deeply into the understanding of what each aspect gave a student. And of course, this came from our own experience of being students at the same time. One of my questions overall through this has been this question: is Usui Shiki Ryoho a complete system? Are we missing something? Do we have everything we need for a spiritual path? Do we have everything we need to fulfill our healing practice and so on? And I believe that we came out of this week, last week, with the answer yes, as far as I know. So that's been really wonderful, because it allows me then to take and go forward from here with an understanding that I'm operating from what I would call a whole, that there's nothing missing. Now, how can I take the four aspects that have been specifically used in my practice and say that these are aspects for all Reiki practices? Well, of course, it's not my place to say this and have it be the truth of the universe. However, I see that the essence of Usui Shiki Ryoho is that students have the connection to Reiki. And in that connection to Reiki, there are, I believe, inherent things that happen. Number one, we get connected to our spirit, and we get we have the capacity to connect to other human beings. And in this process of using Reiki, of allowing universal life energy to flow through us, things in our personality that aren't congruent, things that we learn socially about other people or about other cultures or about how the world works, if they're not congruent with our experience, then they're brought up for us to choose and to say, well, that's actually not my experience. I think I should look for another belief system, or at least use my experience as a basis for my own understanding of the meaning of life and what the basis of relationship is. So when we get down to being humans and practicing Reiki, I believe that these four aspects come to us and form this structure that allows us as human beings to find out who we are and to engage in a path of self-investigation and self-development. So in that path, there are, I believe, two basic lessons. They're not the only ones, but they're the two of the most important ones. And one of them is to reconnect to nature, to our natural place in the universe, in the planet. And what I mean by that is when Christianity formed more than 2,000 years ago, there was something that happened that nature became evil. It's like when Adam and Eve were thrown out of the Garden of Eden, and the snake was a part of nature and became a part of that process, somehow there was good and evil born. And this good and evil, nature became kind of the representation of evil. And out of that, man became, one of the duties of mankind was to control nature and to be sure that it became beneficial for mankind. And I feel like that's part of why we are in the process that we are in now with our planet, is because we've separated ourselves. And one of the things that happens with Reiki is that, of course, in the very beginning, we get connected to our naturalness of being a part of the planetary life form, and also understand, in addition, that something that looks very good can sometimes have underlying painful lessons, and other things that are very painful and shameful can actually emerge as a part of our strength and our source for understanding. So this kind of dualistic separateness of good and bad, positive and negative, and so on, kind of begins to melt away. And what we have is a paradoxical situation. And without these paradoxes, evolution and growth don't happen. So there are other words that I use now, which are activating and restraining forces, which are found in nature naturally and create nature and the evolution of everything that happens on our planet, including ourselves. So this was a long introduction, and I'd like to just be able to go on with the questions. But before I do, I wonder if there are questions from the listeners on the website of clarification, or if you, Rachel, have a question that you feel like we clarify things more. Thanks.
Let me put my headset in because I'm hearing a feedback. So the one very basic clarifying question that I had, I think I got the answer by the end, but the Usui 1 and 2 that you and Paul Mitchell used to teach, or still teach about once a year, those were master intensives going through details of how to teach. And is that if you're actually offering attunements, offering teachings to new practitioners, do you call those Reiki 1 and 2? For me, I just was getting a little confused at that, and if that was a different course from that.
Uh-huh.
So is that right?
I think the answer is no.
Okay.
I'll try to clarify it.
Okay.
So my idea in creating the Usui intensives is that I don't subscribe to masters retaking first and second degree. For me, once you've taken first degree and you've obviously, if you're a master, have committed yourself to this practice, to a practice of Reiki, there is no reason for you to take first degree again. You have it. You've got your practice. It's a part of you. Why should I feel you need to retake it? So this is just my personal philosophy. And the same with second degree. So when people were coming to me and coming to the Alliance and saying, well, what is the practice that you teach? And what is the practice that you practice? We couldn't answer because it was like, okay, well, if you come to my first degree class, then you can get what I teach, but it just didn't feel right. So what the Usui 1 is masters come together, and one of the things that's really interesting is that, number one, usually they're from different countries, they're from different practices, they get to be together to practice Reiki together, like actually do hands-on treatment. And what Paul and I do is, in the Usui 1, we go through the 9 elements of our system and talk about treatment. What does treatment mean for us? Why is it important for the student? What do the hand positions mean? You know, why are we so controlling over the hand positions? Because Reiki, also what we say in Reiki is that Reiki will go where it's needed. So this is one of the paradoxes. You know, we have hand positions and we say you do them like this, but there's this other knowing that Reiki will go where it's needed. So what's the deal, right? So it's really fascinating and really wonderful to be able to talk about these kinds of questions that masters have. And it's really on a master level. It's not on a first degree level.
Yeah.
So we don't say this is the way you teach, because I can't tell you how you teach. I mean,
got it.
You know, everybody's got their style. Some people are real storytellers. Other people are kind of more scientific, which is not my bag. Other people, you know, do something else, and other people are very experiential. So what we do is we really go deeply as much as possible into treatment, into the symbols. There's this whole wonderful thing that happens when human beings connect with the symbol. And we live these symbols, and they are our entrance into a world that I call the unseen world, or the mystery. And it is Reiki that builds this connection with the mystery so that we become familiar with it, and it's not scary. And of course, the biggest mystery is when we die. So if we could take this, you know, comfort with being with mystery into the time when we're dying, then dying can become a much more conscious process, which for me is one of the gifts of Reiki as well. So we take each of the different elements and talk about them, and then and answer questions from people.
Okay.
You know, like, why aren't there set treatments for breast cancer? Why aren't there set treatments for this? Why do we have hand positions? You know, all these different questions.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then when we finish, many people want to go on to the Usui 2, and we ask them to take a year to integrate what they've learned in Usui 1, because for many masters, there are two things that happen. They find out that what they were told Hawaii Takata taught, she didn't teach. And they also find out that what they naturally connected to as a part of Reiki really is a part of Reiki, even though they weren't taught it. So it's like a confirmation. And these two things that are very potent for masters need to be integrated and to be at peace with it. And then if masters are willing to change their form of practice from whatever they were to Usui Shiki Ryoho, or for Usui Shiki Ryoho masters to deepen their understanding of the practice that they hold, then they come to the Usui 2. And then we really go through the actual form of each of the different elements. And it is a kind of, I wouldn't want to say instruction, but we do talk about how to teach. Like, for instance, one of the things that I dropped when I was a new master was something called the final stroke that Hawaii Takata did every time. And I didn't like it because I couldn't figure out how to teach it. And it didn't make any sense to me. And because of that, I just thought, well, it doesn't really matter. So I dropped it. And when when Paul and I talked exchanged treatments with the other Takata masters and so on, I realized that everybody was doing it except me. So I thought, well, okay, I got to add it back in. And, you know, it's difficult to teach it if you don't understand what we figured out over the last year. So we go through a process of how to teach the final stroke, for instance, so on. So they don't have any, in some sense, they are a part and an education of Reiki practice, but we're not teaching you how to practice, and we're actually not teaching you how to teach. We're sharing information that we've gleaned and that we've experienced through all of our years of practice in this practice to other masters. And it's really neat because the longer we have offered these intensives, the more we've come to see that if you practice Reiki and if you teach Reiki for 20 years, Reiki teaches you what's important and what's not important. And so a lot of the things that people were taught even or picked up themselves because they were not secure about what they were teaching get dropped automatically. And the things that are important get added or are more emphasized. So we just see that there's this maturation process that's happening with our Reiki community. which I'm really excited about and very thrilled that I could be a part of it. Yeah. So is that more clear?
Yes, that's much more clear on what the classes were. And I also, since our talk today is about the four elements,
aspects.
So there were four aspects and nine elements. I want to make sure I'm clear and that our community is clear on what those are. What I'm gathering is that the four aspects are things that in your experience and your colleagues' experience and the experience of the masters who are coming through these intensives, that there were four very clear aspects of what the experience of Reiki practice is. When those were spiritual discipline, a healing practice where we're actually experiencing emotional as well as physical healing. So I had spiritual discipline, and we had mystic order, which is sort of just these mystic experiences that we have as individuals, but then collectively feel connected about because we all share this experience and these unseeable, unknowable things that we just share in common as practitioners, and then personal development or personal practice, that this is, you know, separate from a spiritual discipline. I just want some clarity on that and where those come from, and then what the nine elements are in relation to those. I want to make sure I'm really clear on that before we move into the questions.
Okay.
So thank you.
Great. So the four aspects are, let's see, healing practice, personal development, spiritual discipline, and mystic order. And here's a sentence that hopefully will assist. The practice of Reiki offers students a healing practice that leads the way to personal development, that allows people to touch their spirit and come into a spiritual discipline. And those who do this spiritual discipline create a community, which is a mystic order. Okay, so how this works is, this isn't for everyone. So not everybody comes to a Reiki class saying, how can I heal my headaches, right? But a lot of people do. So one of the things that Paul said very early on, which I just really love, is he says, you know, when we work with Reiki, Reiki heals us enough to go to the next step. It's a constant process. So when we do our healing practice, when we do treatments, when we send treatments in the distance, if you're second degree, when we experience treatments by other people treating us, this is a healing practice. But it is more than just the act of putting our hands on or having somebody put their hands on us. It's the whole concept that I am a human being and that I can be whole and that this is a way for me to find my wholeness. So, you know, it's like really when I first started to practice Reiki, I had been working with people in this is totally not correct language right now, but I was involved in a handicapped ski program. And, I taught little kids who had Down syndrome and other forms of developmental processes, arrested developmental processes. Anyway, I taught them how to ski, and they discovered their wholeness in skiing. I mean, they could do everything everybody else could. It was just wonderful. And they so enjoyed it. I mean, it just brings bliss. So then, you know, I saw people who were amputees and people who were blind and, you know, all these different disabilities. And then I came back with Reiki, and we would give them Reiki treatments. And I would think, well, how are these people going to, like, Reiki's not going to give them back their eyesight, and Reiki's not going to grow an arm, so why am I doing this? And what I realized was that my idea of healing, I mean, was totally of the relative world. You know, it was like, how do I bake a cake? But that wasn't the point. The point was, we are all whole in the absolute. It doesn't matter if we have two legs or no legs. It doesn't matter if we can, you know, add and subtract or write our name. Wholeness has nothing to do with my own concept of how to be a human being in the 21st century, right? Wholeness has to do with being. And this is the part that Reiki taught me. So healing practice encapsulates all of this and more for me. And then out of our healing practice, there's this personal development piece. And, you know, I feel that this, the concentration of this has been up to now in kind of personality issues, you know, like belief systems and universal constructs, like how the world works, like the idea of somebody being a glass half full or a glass half empty person, you know, and so on, and those kind of things. And changing and maturing into understanding that if we are willing to accept what's so, like, I'm going to be 5'4", I'm never going to be 5'10", and that's just so. I mean, this was a real issue for me up until I was like 35 years old, that I wasn't going to grow anymore, that I was going to be short for the whole of my life. I mean, this was really weird. Was one of my strange things. And, you know, I still envy people who are tall, but now I don't spend my nights having nightmares about being short. So, you know, these are the kinds of things that happen in personal development. They are very deep, and who knows, maybe they came from a past life. I have no idea. And then, you know, as I do this, I get in touch with my spirit, and I think, well, am I going to, you know, I tell people one of the first things that happens in a student's life in spiritual discipline is I tell them, you have to treat yourself, I want you to treat yourself every day for the rest of your life. That's your homework. So they get up in the morning, the telephone is ringing, the dog's barking to be let out, the kids are screaming, how are you going to treat yourself for a half an hour before you get out of bed? Well, maybe you don't, but do you have the discipline to find a half an hour sometime in the rest of your day, right? So this is like the very nitty-gritty spiritual discipline. You know, how can you really choose to take time off and go get a Reiki treatment when you know that that's what you really need? You know, or can you take and go visit a friend because that's who you need to talk to in the moment and forget about cleaning your kitchen sink? You know, these are the things that are really everyday for me, spiritual discipline, that works into an understanding that we are on a spiritual path. Human beings are. And that spiritual path for me is not about the dogma or the practice of the spiritual path. It's about understanding that the relative world is given to us so that we can learn that we are spirit. Mm-hmm. And that the relative world lessons create our character so that we can pass on the wisdom of our spirit and the wisdom, the collective wisdom of humanity. And then when we all practice together, what happens in my first degree classes, and I'm sure most of first degree classes, that people, you know, do their first Reiki treatments, you know, treating each other in their first degree class. And that act of having an experience that supersedes our physical understanding of who we are as human beings, this flash of oneness that often happens at the time, this feeling of coming home, whatever that means for people, that's a mystic experience. And and that we all arrive at that doing the same practice, that becomes a mystic order. And I believe that we're not quite there yet because we need to have more substance as a spiritual practice, but we still have these mystic experiences, not just, you know, in our daily life, but also we have huge mystic experiences. Like sometimes when we're in a Reiki gathering of like 150 people and something happens that's totally amazing, you know, it just, I don't know, it's like we really get, yes, we're stepping into being a community that that is based on understanding that we carry mystery. We are the mystery, we are a part of the mystery, and we connect to mystery. And that's a part of who we are as human beings. And we get there through the same practice. That's the order part. Yeah. So is that clear?
That is clear. Thank you.
Great.
And
what I'd like to do about the nine elements is just to not go there too much. We've spoken about a lot of the nine elements, like initiation, symbols, treatment, oral tradition, history, form of teaching, money, and the precepts or principles. So those are the nine elements. And they actually contain the actual form of the practice. So your nine elements and what's inside of them, or if there are nine elements, would contain maybe a little bit different information than my nine elements, but I actually feel like we all have something like them. They just aren't articulated. Yeah.
Got it. Uh-huh. So we do have a handful of questions that were submitted in advance that I'd like to get to. There's just one clarifying question over in the chat. Donna asked, did the aspects develop successively or spontaneously together?
Well, the real answer to this question is, Donna, I don't know. But what happened is that when I was asked to describe the practice that I teach and that was handed down through Hawaii Otakata, the aspects came together because they occur together. Like for me, every Reiki treatment that I give has a percentage, sorry to use this word, but it's has a degree, sorry, I use this word, has a degree of the four aspects. Like, for instance, I've been, when I was working here in Moscow, I had Reiki treatments every afternoon. We all shared Reiki. And there were moments in that Reiki treatment where I feel like what I needed was to have Reiki to maintain my energetic levels of and my physical level so that I could continue with the facilitation of the work that I was doing. At the same time, this is most likely my last trip to Russia, and so I've been in grieving as well. And so the treatments allowed me to process that grief. I would call that personal development. And spiritually, it connected me. Like when there were almost 60 masters who were in this group. And when we practiced together, the energetic in that room and the connection to spirit was so palpable that it enhanced everything that we did. So they all come together, but then there are other treatments that I've had where I just go off into some bliss somewhere and I feel like I'm with the mystery for the whole time, and that's 90% of my treatment. So they all come together. They're just in different degrees.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Great. So our first question submitted in advance is actually, the way that he worded it is really in line with a lot of your process that you described. And it comes from Vigard, who wrote, in terms of teaching the first two Reiki degrees, could you share how you may be covering these four aspects? Any insights and advice in terms of what you have found works well for students to understand and take on board the different degrees? To explain where I'm coming from with this question is that I see Reiki as a part of the wider journey, and those who come to it, and for some it may be very early days of what one might call as a conscious spiritual journey. Therefore, I am taking the approach to keep things simpler in the first degree so it is more accessible and understandable, then encouraging people to go deeper in the second degree and talk about things like personal development in different terms when people have had experience with Reiki and this notion. So that's from Vigard, and thank you for that question. Here's Phyllis.
Thank you. I just typed in the nine elements and I have to count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Yeah. Great.
Yeah. Okay. So this question, really interesting. It is my experience that the most important way to communicate the four aspects of our practice is to embody them. I don't talk about the four aspects, like I don't say to first degree students, and this, and in this practice we have four aspects. But what I try to do in the class is to point out where we are. Like, of course, healing practice is at the forefront of most of the first degree class because it's physical, you know, and physical healing practice is also very understandable. It's physical, it, you know, people can talk about it. But sometimes questions come from students like, well, I have a brother who's schizophrenic. Will I be able to do Reiki on them? And then you say, well, of course. And it, for me, the answer would be, and it is important if this brother is under care of a professional that they know that they're receiving Reiki, because Reiki will bring out things that might be new or different input. And so it's good if the professional caregiver understands that they are also getting Reiki. And then, you know, we talk about personal development, what happens in the class, and also about, I tell the student that I'm sharing my spiritual practice with them, and that it is something that they can choose for themselves, and that they might find after a few years that it's chosen them, that they have entered into a spiritual practice without actually knowing it or choosing it, and that that's a part of this Reiki path. And when people come to me and say, you know, I had this very weird experience last night in the initiation. I had this image of your grandmother, and she felt very real, right? And I go, yes. And they think, well, you're not surprised. And I say, yes, I'm not surprised, because Reiki gives us a connection into the mystery. And part of that mystery is this connection with somebody that might not be living on the planet now, or actually they might be something that we don't know about, like colors. Like, where do all the colors come from? That's a part of a mystic experience. So I give them this in a way that they actually experience it. And it grows, you know, it grows like a flower.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
I love that. I have students who have very vivid images of your grandmother during attunements. Uh-huh. Yeah. that's
great.
Cool. Our next question that was submitted in advance came from Anu. And Anu wrote, some clients heal quickly from a health issue, like a sleep disorder, even trigeminal neuralgia, and others with same issue get worse with the symptoms and stop taking Reiki. How do we understand this or try to explain to the client, especially if they have come on a referral from a client with the same symptoms? Thanks, Anu.
This is a great question, and my answer is that in allopathic medicine, the perspective to the human being is through a diagnosis. And from Reiki, the perspective is from the person and then the symptoms that are being displayed. So doctors tend to, well, they're trained to treat diabetes, and this is the prescribed treatment. And if it doesn't work, then they try to find another prescribed treatment that might work better, because they have a different, and then they, you know, break it down into all these different diabetes conditions and so on. And what happens is that in Reiki, we go to the person. So every person has their own path. And a part of that path is the physical symptomology and condition that they have. And so that's why the results of Reiki treatments are so widely different for each person, because each person has their path. So someone could have the same kind of breast cancer, for instance, and exactly the same degree of intensity and so on, and one person could have three Reiki treatments and it seems to just be gone and never comes back. And the same, another person can have the same treatment, and it seems like the cancer is getting more and more virulent, you know, gain strength, and eventually the person dies. Well, why is that? It's because each person has that cancer to learn, for me, to mark a certain place on their path. And it isn't about whether or not they're a good person or a bad person, because there aren't good and bad people, they're just people. Whether they've done all the right things. So there are people who are vegetarian, who have eaten only organic food, who exercise every day, and they have great lifestyle, and they have cancer. But other people who live terrible lifestyles and eat junk food, they don't have cancer. Like, why is that? It's because each person walking their path has their own path. And Reiki supports that path, whatever that path is. And that's one of the very interesting issues when Reiki is called in to hospitals to provide support, because we can't guarantee the results. We can guarantee that the person will become at peace with their path. But what that path is, I don't know.
Great. I hadn't considered it that way. Thank you, Phyllis.
Yeah.
Our next
sense for me personally.
Yeah, me too. Our next question came from Philippe, who wrote, how do the aspects relate to human life from birth through death as we age, and especially the last years? We seem to get all the usual sickness. Are these preventable? Thank you, Philippe, for the question.
Philippe. Well, I'll start at the beginning, at the end, and go back. I think some conditions are totally preventable. And, you know, like if I have a family that's prone to diabetes and I'm able to walk every day, then I believe that that actually allows me, and be supported by Reiki, I believe that allows me a possibility of not encouraging this condition in my body. So there are those kinds of things that you can do, and especially, I'm sorry, I don't know very much about how to say these things, but I know there's a kind of diabetes that comes when you age, because when you age, you stop being so physically active, and then your body metabolism doesn't work as well. So it's one of the things that I kind of live with an eye on, and it doesn't, unfortunately, it doesn't get me to walking, which I should do, but it is a possibility. So this is, yes, we can prevent things, because it's like, it has the same kind of energy as if you look both ways before you step out on a street, you probably prevent yourself from being hit by a car. And that's, you know, kind of how it is for me. Our body ages, and that's just how it is. It's part of the life path. You know, I think when I used to be 45 or 50 or something, I forgot that I was a baby, and that when I was born, I had a cleft palate, but I don't have a lip that was split, a cleft lip. And so I had a lot of pain in my mouth and in my head when I was really an infant, because I couldn't eat because everything came into my sinuses and so on. So it was very interesting, and I think I just blanked out that part that I was ever a baby. But, you know, we have to remember that we were babies and that we grew up and we grew through all these stages of development until we got to adulthood. And somehow we also have this idea that from the age of 21 to 60, we're all the same. but we're not. Our bodies, parts of our bodies still develop and grow and change, and then they reach their climax of their development, and then they start descending. And they all do it at different parts, at different times of our life. And it depends on how much physical activity you have, what your diet is, how much you connect to your spirit. There are all these different factors. So that's why it's very difficult to say to somebody, okay, well, your lifestyle just leads to cancer, or your lifestyle leads to something else, because it's all individual. I believe, actually, in my belief system, we have every condition of imbalance in our body, because it all comes from our body. And I believe that there were several factors that happened over the years of my being an adult that contributed to the condition of breast cancer appearing in my life. And I could spend a lot of time in regret, but I don't regret what I did, because what I did was a clear choice. And I don't feel like I would have chosen any differently, even if somebody had had a sign, and this will be a time when you get cancer. So I just feel like we need to accept our bodies and their conditions and the messages that come from these conditions. And that Reiki allows us to accept this spectrum of living. So we have the spectrum of being helpless, starting, quote, being helpless. But I'll tell you, babies are not so helpless. They get all the attention in the room immediately when they enter it. And they and the attention of everybody stays with that child until a certain age, and then somehow they grow out of this place. So it's like we start with these things and we end with, again, getting a lot of attention usually. And I think that's really beautiful, but it's very hard to accept that we are a living, developing organism, and that we have no way to stop that. So the most important thing is acceptance of that process, and the aspects for me allow me to understand the depth of the process. It's not just physical. It's like we are every tree, we are every ocean, we are every human being, we are every form of life, and we have all of that in common with every form of life. So if we can move into treating ourselves with that kind of humanity and care, then I believe that we will be more peaceful. So, Philippe, that's the way that I relate to your question.
So we have three more questions that came in advance. I feel like we have time for Edith's question, but Esther and Ng, we may need to hold off and answer in the Facebook group. Phyllis, you can say if you feel different.
Well, on the time. We'll see how the answer comes out.
Yeah. So Edith's question is, where is the meeting point between being more and more authentic, letting go of a lot of self-constructed images, and becoming a harsher person with spirituality and evolution? Thank you for your question, Edith.
Yeah, What I'm kind of confused about is the word harsher, because I'm not, the English is a little confusing. So it's like letting go of self-constructed images. Okay, I've got that. Because you do that when you become more authentic. And then is it that you become a more honest person and therefore people have a reaction to that? And so you say this as a harsher person? I don't know, Edith, if you're online right now, but if you are and you can help me with this word harsher, that'd be great. So where is the meeting point between being more and more authentic with spirituality and evolution? We're not getting a little note from Edith, so I'll have to just guess.
I'm doing an experiment. I've never actually done this on one of these before, but it looks like Edith raised her hand. So I just clicked to see if she can come on as an actual speaker. So Edith, I think you need to have a Gmail account in order. It's gonna prompt you and ask you to log in. If you have that, go ahead and do that, and we'll get you on to talk with Phyllis once that happens. Otherwise, type into the chat. So, all right.
Oh, I see a little hand like this.
Yeah?
Okay. Can I go on to the next question and see if she can get in?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So the next question came from Esther. And Esther wrote, mystic order is at times difficult to explain, as the other person might have his or her idea when hearing about it, thinking probably it is some kind of a strange organization. How do you suggest that we explain it in these cases? Thank you. And thank you, Esther, for your question.
Esther, well, I can see from many points of view that a mystic order is a strange organization. So I think that that's no problem. We are strange. We're very unusual in this world. So I wouldn't worry about being a strange organization. So when I talk to people who do not practice Reiki, and so I can't go to their experience of Reiki to demonstrate a mystic experience, I say that mystic is a term that is used when a human being has an experience of the mystery without going through another person. So, for instance, in organized religion, priests and rabbis and ministers create the possibility of their parishioners having a mystic experience, and the unspoken understanding is that they must go through them in order to have this experience. Now, I have no judgment about whether this is better or worse. It's just that's how it is. For other orders, other spiritual practices, where we have access to the mystery on our own without this, usually one of the oldest mystic orders is the Sufi order. And what they have done is they have a practice that is a practice of chants and chanting and movement, and then eventually coming into being the mystery, and they dance with it. And this particular peace, what happens when you're a Sufi is that you live this also in your daily life. And so I just love the stories of when people become students of a Sufi student. They don't become students for long, because if they're really Sufis, they have to go and live in a Sufi community. They be Sufi, right? So I feel like we're getting to that stage. I don't know if we'll have Reiki communities, but I think that there will be so many people in a already community that there will be communities that we actually live in, that Reiki will be a daily part of who we are, and that we be Reiki. So that's what I talk to people about. And really, don't worry about being strange. Okay. So we have heard nothing else from Edith.
Right. We've heard nothing else from Edith, not in the chat either. It's possible she had to log out before we got to her question. Okay. Saw that.
She raised her hand. Let me just quickly meet this. Is that all right?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. What is the meeting point between being more and more authentic, maybe, and letting go of self-construction, spirituality, and evolution? Well, the more we come to be comfortable with living with our spirit and living in a spiritual practice, we automatically become more authentic, because our spirit doesn't allow for self-deception and deception of lifestyle. And this evolves, so I use the word evolution, this evolves us to becoming more and more honest. Now, in that honesty, sometimes our communication skills are not developed as much as our spirit is. So sometimes, you know, our honesty can come out being harsh. And so bear with me if you can handle this. So that is a sign for me that concentration is needed in the personal development aspect. Harshness comes because underlying whatever is happening, there is some belief system or there is some experience that is still not completed, not accepted. And so it like leaks out, even though at the moment we're in spiritual bliss, there's still this leaking underlying thing that happens, and it comes out in the most odd ways. So that's that possibility. But the other possibility, which is people seeing you as harsh or seeing you as being too honest, well, you can't help that. That's just how it is. And that's something that is important for me, that I just say to people, look, you know, I'm really direct. And they often say to me, because I travel a lot, oh, what can I do to take care of you? You know, what can I do to make you more comfortable? And I can say, well, you know, right now I need my alone time. And what you could do for me is drop me off at my hotel, and I'll call you when I want to see you, because I need to have my alone space. Now, for people who have a lot of social need to have a lot of social contact with me in this period of time, they're not going to be very happy. But I hope that at some point they get that if I'm given that space, then the time that I have with them, even though it might be a shorter time span, will be much deeper because I will be able to be much more present.
Yeah.
So this is a really interesting process, and I hope, Edith, that I have addressed your question. Thank you.
Yeah, I really appreciate your response, Phyllis, so thank you. So we're moving into the closing, but we have a really exciting announcement, so please stick around. And actually, if you've been sitting for a long time, give yourself a big stretch, because I'm about to change the tone just a little bit. We have a really exciting opportunity for you coming up. It's actually our next Global Reiki webinar. It's going to be a little bit different than the ones that we have offered in the past. And a part of it is actually one of these four aspects that we've been talking about today. Healing practice is a topic that you, the Global Reiki community, have had so many questions about, and specifically healing practice and how it moves into the form of a professional practice or a public practice. And there were so many questions and so many topics, like smaller subtopics that could be covered under you know, the idea of healing practice and from healing practice into professional practice. So actually being in hospitals, being in medical arenas, offering Reiki, practicing Reiki as a form of healing practice and healing experience, and what are the things that we have to do with that. So what we've decided to do is actually offer, for the first time, an online weekend intensive with Phyllis Furumoto and myself. I don't think I said in the beginning, I'm Rachel. Good to meet you if it's your first time here. And it's going to be July 16th and 17th of this year. And this is also going to be the first Global Reiki webinar that actually has a tuition to participate. And there's a number of reasons for that. One is it's a lot of time. It's two full days. We'll have four sessions that you'll be able to come in, and it's going to be very intimate. So our intention is to limit enrollment to only 30 participants. And what we'd like to do is give each participant an opportunity to actually come in and discuss with us the topics that come up throughout the weekend live, via video, via your webcam. So if this is a topic that you know you're interested in, if you're doing Reiki in hospitals, if you have a personal healing experience or something that you're coming, utilizing Reiki as a modality to move through, and you really want to discuss live with Phyllis, this is your opportunity to do that without actually traveling. You'll just need to find a comfortable place and make sure that you have a webcam and a Gmail account to be able to log in and to communicate with us live via video. So what I've done is put up the registration link. There's a little button there, that orange button, and you're not automatically registered when you go there, but you'll have a much longer course description that Phyllis has written up for you to review and decide if this is really something that's for you. And if you feel yes, you absolutely want one of those 30 spots to be with us at July 16th and 17th for the full weekend, then below that description, there's a form for you to fill out. So that's the first part of the registration. And you'll give us your name, your email, and also a little bit, I'm curious, and Phyllis is also curious about who you are and what you're actually coming to this event with. What's your personal experience, what you're interested in throughout the weekend when we're diving in deep on, you know, moving from healing practice to professional practice. And then once you submit that form, we're going to personally review your information. And there's also the next step in your registration is to actually click through that next page and submit your tuition And there's information about that on that course description page. So if you're curious about that, go ahead and click the button. It'll open in a separate page. Those of you who are on live with us for this webinar are having first access to that registration. And if you know you're a yes for that, go ahead and register. And otherwise, if there are some spaces available, we'll be sending it out to you through other channels. So those of you who have enjoyed this experience, this global Reiki webinar, are new to it, are really appreciative of this experience. If you'd like to offer us a gift or Phyllis a gift for creating this experience, there have been people in the past who like to send us a monetary gift through PayPal. And the way that you would do that is just go through PayPal and send it to reikiwebinars@gmail.com. And of course, that's available in the Facebook group as well as our YouTube replays. So I'm going to keep that registration link for the first ever online weekend intensive with Phyllis Furumoto so that you can click through, open that up. If you're curious a little bit, go ahead and read through the description. And to close out this particular webinar, let's take a moment to just engage in self-Reiki or distance Reiki to our collective highest purpose if that's part of your practice. And thank you for being here. Thank you for being a part of this really exciting thing. And let's practice. Thank you all for being here. I'm seeing the gratitude, seeing that Edith thanks you, Phyllis, for answering her question. She apologizes for technical problem, but your answer was perfect. We're glad that you were here and you received that. Thank you, everyone, for being here. If you have something else to say, we'll keep the chat open for more gratitude and goodbyes and connections between you who are with us live. And whether you're with us live or watching the replay, head on over to the Facebook group, Global Reiki Webinars, and join the discussion there. Share your reactions and any other questions. And peace, love, and Reiki.